facts about the ancient Egyptian tree of life. The tree of life was a potent ancient Egyptian symbol and icon in the mythology and legends of Egypt. According to ancient Egyptian mythology, the mythical tree of life, the fruit of which provided eternal life and knowledge of the cycles of time. Knowledge. The tree of life provides knowledge. Maybe it doesn't provide life. Maybe it just provides knowledge. Maybe they should call it the tree of knowledge. Okay, the tree of life fact file. The tree of life was one of the most potent symbols of ancient Egypt, symbolizing knowledge of the divine plan, or equivalent to a map of destiny. It gives you a knowledge of the future.
Kabbalah gives people a vision of something that doesn't yet exist in actuality, but which our soul sees. It awakens us to a vision of the future.
Fruit. Eating the fruit of the sacred issue tree of life was a guarantee of eternal life. But again, nobody's living forever. Zohar, Bereshith to Lech Lecha. Bereshith is in the beginning, that's Genesis 1. Lech Lecha is Genesis 12 through 17, and it's Lech Lecha means to go out. Abraham going out, get thee out. Let's begin. This is the only extensive translation of a portion of the Zohar, the longest and one of the most important texts of the Kabbalah. Zohar is a Kabbalistic commentary on the Hebrew Bible. Long before the Bible code, Jewish scholars were attempting to wring deep meaning out of every syllable of the text of the Hebrew Bible, using numerology, gematria, and other techniques. Let's take a look at anything that pops out here. Ah. Abraham's first studies in occultism.
Mystery school, there's something more that can help me. Is that true?
Abraham's initiation into the lesser mysteries. Abraham's descent into Egypt for initiation into the higher mysteries.
Previously, this information could be found only within the inner world, in secret societies, in hidden organizations, and mystery schools. The world is currently going through a transitory phase into a new consciousness. The viral power of social media allows us to reach millions with this information.
Here are 9, 5 plus 4, get it? Jewish things you may not know about Star Wars. Again with this number 9.
Adam Sandler will host Saturday Night Live May 4th. 5-4. When is this reported? 4-5. 2019. 4 or 5. 5 plus 4 equals 9. 4 plus 5 equals 9. 5 best Adam Sandler movies and the 4 worst. 5-4. Why?
What time does the sun hit the map room?
About 9 in the morning.
The sacred tree of life is connected with the creation myth and the 9 gods of the Ennead of Heliopolis. 9.
So let's do this. 6 plus 6 plus 6 is 18. 1 plus 8 is 9. So the reduction in occult numerology, in gematria, of 666 is 9.
This is the symbol of all the mystery traditions. Okay? Very simply, It is the symbol of all occultism.
And Dr. Jones, we've heard a great deal about you.
Have you? Professor of archaeology, expert on the occult. Expert on the occult.
Of course, it is Egyptian in its thematic representation, in its symbolic representation, it is Egyptian, and there is a reason for that. We have to understand a little bit about Egyptian cosmology and the main solar god, the solar disk, which we looked at as Horus, as Ra. Set is the dark incarnation of it. Really, all of these principles could be encapsulated as one solar god known as Aten or Aton, depending on the spelling. It could be spelled A-T-O-N or A-T-E-N. So Akhenaten of 18th dynasty Egypt was actually named after this. He's a pharaoh of 18th dynasty. He brought in the concept into Egyptian cosmology of a one god that is the overarching ruling aspect of everything, known as the Aten. And he named himself after this god. Akhenaten means the spirit of the Aten, the solar god. So that is the being here, the Aten. Now that could mean a couple of things depending on how we look at this symbol. But let's just let it be seen as it is the solar principle, the solar god, the god of light, the bringer of light. So it could be also seen as the word Lucifer.
Now turn your attention to the all-seeing eye watching over the construction. The eye is located at the top of the pyramid. It's where the construction is headed. It's the goal. It's that towards which the pyramid strives. But remember, the pyramid represents the process of evolution. And so the all-seeing eye represents the end goal of evolution. What is this goal? Humanity has the potential to become gods and goddesses.
Ruling for nearly 7 decades, Ramses II was the pharaoh of pharaohs. From childhood, all the hopes for his dynasty rested on him, and he was treated with a reverence usually reserved for the gods themselves.
Picture of the Tree of Life. The picture of the Tree of Life depicts a scene from the tomb of Ramses II, in which his name is recorded and inscribed on the leaves of the Tree of Life.
So one can be truly illuminated and really possess the light, really possess the knowledge, and then there is one who can be born into the dark light. Those who have knowledge of how things really work, but the way they're using it is for the ego. Being my will be done because I view myself as God and separate from everyone else, and I am out there to manipulate and rule them.
Who or what is Satan to you?
Satan is the essence of that which dwells within myself.
Five, 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 0123.
Denied that promotion at work? Is life unfair? Is there someone less talented than you reaping all the benefits? Is your name Bruce? Then do we have the job for you? We're located at 77256 23rd Street. So come on down, or we'll just keep beeping you.
Okay, move along. Where are we? We're in a virtual reality universe, which only exists in our head in the physical sense that we perceive. We are decoding vibrational and electrical information into this apparently physical world that only exists in this form in our heads. One level it's digital, and like I say, electrical signals decoded by our brain. So that's where this world actually resides.
You are dreaming right now, and me talking to you is a message from yourself trying to get you to wake up. I know it sounds crazy. We're going to explain it right now as I show you how to wake up from this dream. The philosopher Bishop Berkeley said that this reality is a dream in the divine mind. The occultist Aleister Crowley knew that this existence was not material, but a mental existence. And he founded Thelema, which is the core belief system of the secret society known as the Ordo Templi Orientis. Aleister Crowley's Thelema is largely based on the Kabbalah, and in the diagram of the Tree of Life, it shows that this existence is an existence within the mind, that mind is the ultimate reality. And from this mind, an emanation occurs of going to lower and lower forms of existence until you finally reach the lowest form of existence, which they call Malkut, which is this shared dream that we exist in right now. The esoteric imagery of the secret society of the Freemasons also depicts this emanation from the one mind into a dream reality. The symbol of the great eye depicts the awakening of the cosmic mind in this shared dream.
There's this common thought that says that we create our reality by our thoughts, our feelings, our emotions, and actually the reins are in your hands. You want to create a good life for yourself. You want to prevent bad things. Think what you want, prevent what you don't want, live in the state you already want to be in, and then you'll realize the kind of life that you want. Like, reality is this big store that I simply have to know how to change my thoughts, and then I can get anything I want from it.
The number 77 is very significant. It is the 14. It is the dark aspect of that light in the triangle, the ego.
Omnipresence.
The all-seeing eye that is identified with building that pyramid upward. The physical form, the physical world, ruling, control, sorcery. That, in that symbol, the Aten or Lucifer represents the sorcerer, and he is completely trapped in ego. The ego-bound consciousness, it's the I in the triangle. I am God, the sorcerer says to the world, and I will make everyone in this world and the entire world in my own image and likeness, but I will have all the light, and the light will be blocked out to those in ignorance and in one form, and the male dominator world will be born into existence, and it will bathe the world forever in darkness. That's the negative connotation of this symbol.
Every facet of the temple's design was meant to send a clear message to all who entered that Ramses the Great was a god among the living.
Ramses II is shown not only worshiping the gods, but worshiping an image of his own deified self. So you have Ramses II as pharaoh, worshiping Ramses II as god.
The ever-youthful figure pictured in the Tree of Life is the pharaoh Ramses II. Depicted with his symbols of kingship, crown, flail, and scepter. The figure to the left is the ibis-headed god Thoth, who was the god of wisdom, magic, and the measurement, and regulation of events and of time. The god of knowledge, tree of knowledge. He was the secretary of the sun god Ra, and scribe of the underworld, and inscribed the names of the pharaoh on the tree of life.
To prevent you from becoming god, the old world order keeps you on your knees and enslaved to an imaginary god. Wouldn't you prefer to become a deity rather than be a slave to a fabricated one?
And then I crawled through the crowd and jumped up behind the piano and began to sing, "I hate you all, you gave me cancer." And the whole audience laughed, except for five people who stood around the piano and said, "You are a god." You are a god.
Oh, well, let's take a look at some of this.
Abraham, at the time of his call, was far from being perfect in his relationship to the Holy One, and knowledge of divine science, and, in these words for spoken unto him, allusion is made to the true path, a manner of spiritual ascension by which the soul of man is able to become harmonized and assimilated with the divine being. The fruit of the tree of life was not available to mortals only in the rituals related to eternity in which the gods refreshed aging pharaohs. So only the pharaohs were eating this, which further symbolized the pharaoh's unity with the gods. Pharaoh's unity with the gods. Remember that.
You'll notice that everything in the image is material, except for the all-seeing eye, which watches over the great work from the immaterial domain. But why is the eye opened now? You see, those of us that have become conscious of what we are the directors of evolution. We are the watchers of the great work. The great eye has opened, and we are the eye. You have the potential to come into this consciousness as well.
Ramses II is shown not only worshiping the gods, but worshiping an image of his own deified self. So you have Ramses II as Pharaoh, worshiping Ramses II as God, all taking place during the lifetime of Ramses II.
The heart of the temple is its sanctuary, which lies more than 200 feet inside the mountain. Within it are four statues of Egypt's mightiest gods: Ptah, the creator; Amun, the supreme god; Ramses, the living god; and Ra Harakhti, the sun god.
Looking for room 7.
What does the wisdom of Kabbalah say about this approach, about the power of our thought, about our ability to influence reality with our thoughts? Yes, as it says, everything is scrutinized in thought, and it's true. What do you mean? It means that a person can change himself, and through himself, the entire reality that he feels, only by the power of thought.
I'm free on the 7th! That's 7!
7th, that's 7 it is.
This looks promising. Hello?
Another gigantic, ginormic waste of my life.
Hello? Yo, I'm looking for whoever runs this joint.
Be right with you. I'm trying to fix a light. Tell me if it's working.
Yeah, seems to be. Kind of bright, though.
Yeah, it is for most people. Spend their lives in the dark, trying to hide from me.
So Mystery School takes the approach that it says a really radical thing. It says not just that, maybe to use a sort of spiritual term here, not just that we're children of Source, God, Goddess, Light, whatever you want to call that, but that we're actually God, Goddesses in training.
And you and Adam will be like gods yourselves.
Suddenly I find a very special method called the wisdom of Kabbalah that explains that what I receive in my senses, it's not that it's necessarily some kind of absolute. No, but that I can change it. How? By changing my senses. Meaning that if I want to change reality, I don't have to change something on the outside, I have to change something on the inside myself, and then reality will change.
It's understandable. I'm standing here now, and everything seems to be outside of me. Everything seems to be out there, but that's an optical illusion. Everything is not out there. It's in here in terms of the physical world. It is within us. Everything is within us.
Because this reality doesn't exist outside of me. This is what I feel and depict inside myself. And you also don't exist.
So I don't believe that you exist, but there is a wonderful fragrance in the air.
You exist in a reality that I'm creating now, and how good it really is. I can be without you, alone, on my own, everywhere. And it's not that this reality exists in and of itself, but I, by my thoughts, form it, create it.
Bruce, I'm God.
Bingo! Yahtzee! Is that your final answer? Our survey says God! Bing, 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 bing!
And I can change it with my thoughts and to feel myself in a completely different reality. Therefore, the power of thought is the main force.
I'm uncomfortable with the thought of this Jewish ritual.
Cosmic thoughts, gentlemen?
We were speculating. Is God really out there?
Maybe he's not out there, boss. Maybe he's right here. Human heart.
Well, it was nice to meet you, God. Thank you for the Grand Canyon, and good luck with the apocalypse.
So this age-old line that goes right the way back through the ages, what we call the ages, to go within, is a stunningly accurate truth. Because this is where this is projected from.
You exist in a mathematical hologram, the holos, and you yourself are a mathematical being, a being of source. You're immersed in a complex of information, of data, of code, and you're becoming aware of yourself as this code. Imagine how much power you would have if you were in a computer simulation and you were able to understand the code in which the simulation was written.
In a way, I brought you here to offer you a job.
A job? What job?
My job. You think you can do it better, so here's your chance. When you leave this building, you will be endowed with all my powers.
Whatever you say, Bill.
Okay, that did not happen. And no one needs to hear about it. I'm deleting the program. No.
No.
I'm not gonna break down, that's what it is. Normal everyday psychotic episode.
The power of thought is the main and highest force in a person, that if a person strengthens it, then eventually, from all these thoughts, he can start determining reality.
You do not need God, you do not have his powers. If that was God, then I'm Clint Eastwood. Holy hell! I am a reasonable, sane human being.
44 Magnum.
Join us. Join the Society of the Divine. Don't worship God. Become God.
God? Are you here? Hello? I need your help!
The thing is that the reality that we feel, all of it depends on our thoughts. By our thoughts, we form, shape, and build our reality.
Well, hello there, Bruce Almighty. Not as easy as it looks, is it, son? This God business.
If now I see feel, hear, in short, through all of my five senses, I sense reality, the reality that I'm in. This is because this is how I have arranged this reality with my thoughts.
Well, you're right on time. 7 o'clock.
7th at 7.
Abraham's descent into Egypt for initiation into the higher mysteries. Well, let's delve into this one.
Come with us to the summit of the pyramid and the perfection of the universe and the perfection of yourself. At the top of the pyramid stand the gods and goddesses, fully optimized, perfected minds. They've reached the hyperpoint, the point above all.
And Abraham went down into Egypt to sojourn there. Here the question may arise, what was the reason and object of his going down into Egypt? It was because at that time Egypt was a great center of learning of theosophy and the science of the divine mysteries, and therefore referred to in scripture as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt.
As the etheric forces and the tree of life are loosened, are opened up, are being quickened, energized in the whole aura of the earth.
Now get up.
We are functionally changing the tuning forks that we use to put ourselves in line with as far as time measurement. Time is accelerating. It's not a relative phenomenon. Things get faster and faster, and more interpenetrating, more intense, and it's never going to slow down. It's just going to keep exponentially leapfrogging. And those of us who can orient or develop the stable state physics of the soul will be able to navigate those new energies. Them, and in the process be able to emulate the miracles of the masters and Jesus, as it were.
Sure.
We will be able to enact the full ability of our higher self, begin to bring it in as creator beings or as co-creator beings. As creator beings, or as co-creator beings.
And see, what the system wants, and one of the key benefits from the system's point of view, for us believing that everything's out there, is it wants us to believe that if we don't like what's out there, or what we perceive to be out there, we must change it out there. But there is no out there. So if we're going to change it out there, we're trying to change symbolically, not even symbolically, very accurately, we're trying to change a movie by screaming at the screen. It's not going to change. The movie's just going to run. We've got to go within and find the projector and what's projecting the movie and change that, and then the movie must change.
This means 6 kadam high.
About 72 inches.
Wait! This means 6 kadam high.
About 72 inches.
Wait! And take back 1 kadam to honor the Hebrew God whose ark this is.
You have only arrived at the 77, which is 2/3 of completion, or it is 14 out of 21, 2/3, right? And this reduces in decimal to 0.666, repeating. So it is the number of the beast in disguise. The sorcerer is the beast.
When you understand the source code that you're composed of and that runs the holos, you'll have access to worlds and power beyond your imagination.
Can I achieve anything that I want if I become proficient in my ability to use my power of thought? Yes, if you'll exactly know what to your benefit means, and that to your benefit and to the benefit of the whole of reality will be one and the same, then undoubtedly you'll be able to attain anything.
You will be independent. You will be what the Kabbalists say, like God, like the Creator, like your Creator.
Hey, Hosanna! Away!
Well, you're right on time. 7 o'clock.
Okay, suppose someone really needs something now, a spouse or a job. What is that change that he has to make in order to have the sufficient power of thought in order to attain it? Again, don't think that you can solve all the problems. So this is what we're asking, what can we and what can't we? It's in accordance with the state of the world.
Anyway, here's the deal. You have all my powers. Use them any way you choose. There are only 2 rules. You can't tell anybody you're God.
There's no thing that isn't divine. Everything is divine, and I'm that.
Believe me, you don't want that kind of attention. And you can't mess with free will.
Oh. Still, in this world, we exist in a limited way. Even that a Kabbalist exists in this world and he can bring about great changes, but still, he's adhered to a certain form in time, history, geography. He's still limited.
What, are you drunk?
Yeah, I'm drunk. Drunk with power.
Love me. Love me. Love me!
I did.
Yeah, I know. Free will.
You want to succeed by the hidden forces of nature. This is what you're asking. How can I, by special thoughts, change reality to my benefit? So I'm telling you, you will be able to change reality to your benefit if you're thinking of changing it to the benefit of others. By the power of my thought? Yes. My power of thought, is it related to love of others? Yeah. But it's my power of thought. If it's yours, then you're like any other animal. You're a beast, and you can't use the spiritual power of thought. So if my thoughts do not transpass my personal interests, then they're still not considered to be thoughts from a higher level, and there's nothing higher about them. It's a beast. It's man in this world. And he has no spirituality or the ability to change the world by his thoughts.
The purpose of Hyperionism is to elevate you to the next level so that you can begin to consciously play the game. Your task, if you did but know it, is to reach the God level of the game.
It wasn't so bad at first feeling like gods. The problem was knowing that none of it was real.
Your journey to this level of the game culminates in the realization of your limitless power and becoming God.
How?
He is the one.
No, again, it's free of religion. Mystery School is not about religion. It's, yes. It doesn't seek to create specific teachings that anyone needs to believe in. But it offers certain teachings and clues along a path of progression that works with initiation, activations and healings, and Kabbalah is a big piece of what we do with Modern Mystery School.
It was because at that time, Egypt was a great center of learning of theosophy and the science of the divine mysteries, and therefore referred to in scripture as the Garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. In it, as in the Garden of Eden, of which it is stated, from the right of it went forth a river called Pison that encompassed the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, flowed a great mystical river of divine knowledge. Tree of knowledge? Very precious and unobtainable elsewhere.
I can form, shape reality by the power of my thoughts the way I want it. Right. On the other hand, I have to take reality into consideration that I can't turn it any which way I want with my thoughts. But if I want to benefit reality as it currently is, then I'm boundless.
People want me to do everything for them, and what they don't realize is they have the power. You want to see a miracle, son? Be the miracle.
This can only change when this changes. Because by the time it hits the screen and becomes this holographic reality, this illusory physical reality, it's a done deal. It's a done deal. There's no changing it now. There's no changing the movie when it hits the screen. It's done. We've got to change it before it hits the screen. And that means going within to the deeper levels of ourselves where we decode this stuff and therefore change it.
Abraham, having entered into the Garden of Eden and become an adept in the secret doctrine that he is God, desirous of passing through all its grades on to, spelling error, the higher mysteries in order to become teleios, or perfect, went down into Egypt where there was gold, or the hidden wisdom. And what's the hidden wisdom? That you are God, reincarnated into your own creation.
And this is the symbol of all masonry. It is the symbol of all builders. And who are the builders? We all are the builders. We are all collectively on this planet the co-creators of our collective experience. Whether we are doing that creation unconsciously or consciously creating our experience.
Wait, are you leaving?
Yeah, I figure you can handle things now.
But we cannot build an entire generation of Jews who only have this knowledge.
I agree.
They will not become, they will not come closer to the Torah, and they will not become closer to God. They will become closer to their own self-serving spiritual high.
I agree.
And
it has to be grounded.
It has to be grounded by the Torah,
yeah.
Which is...
Well, Kabbalah is Torah.
Well, I'm saying by the Torah Sanigla. It is the Torah Sanigla, it is the revealed Torah that grounds us in this world.
Yes.
That makes us good people.
Right.
And that is...
Jacob's ladder was standing on the ground, but it reached the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You have to have both.
And you're right.
Well, what if I need you? What if I have questions?
That's your problem, Bruce. That's everybody's problem. You keep looking up.
Which, you know, would normally be called Jacob's ladder, Jacob's ladder, right? And they would be faith, hope, and charity. But the point is that this central column that we've been ranting on about is in part associated with Jacob. I don't have a quote from the Zohar right now. It just mentions it a lot about the letter Shin and how the three chief patriarchs being Abraham, Isahak or Isaac, and Jacob are tied to one of these three pillars. And the central pillar is Jacob, hence Jacob's ladder. And these three, you could say, rungs in Kabbalah are Aleph, Mem, and Shin. If you look at the Lurianic tree, you'll see it. There are three pieces that ascend in the sense of a three-runged ladder.
It's just a question of which angle you come from. Some people need to start up here, some people need to start down here, and some people from the side. Like you said, 70 ways of doing it.
In Jacob's ladder, only Hashem was on the top. The Malachim were you know, Olim v'Yordim, going up and down.
That's true.
Jacob was on the ground. Only Hashem was on the top.
Right.
One such way that this is significant is that when we observe the traditional Kabbalah, it is described that all of the scriptures that are written about in ancient times are actually allegories for what is happening within us actively at every moment.
How are they supposed to know that it's really deeper than that and it doesn't mean what it actually says it says?
Yes, although it's his will that we should understand those things on the deeper level as well. Okay, so you're doing both. It's part of his will to do what I'm saying, to understand it on a deeper level.
Where does it say that?
Everything that we see is just in our head, everything, friends, family, and the physical way, everything is in our heads and produced digitally in the end. And it's a virtual reality.
We are the builders of this world. And this is what we've built it into, what we currently have right now.
So when I read the Torah, I look at the stories and I'm always looking at it as a metaphor. Not only as a metaphor, those people really existed, but they are also a metaphor on which maps out who I am.
For example, the story of Adam and Eve would be related not to something that may have happened in ancient times, but our own personal story of disconnection with spirit in our everyday lives. We learn from the story about our own innocence and the difference between the tree of knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life, which brings us to this.
Wait, back up. The Kabbalists believe that the story of Adam and Eve is not related to anything that may have happened in ancient times. It's not a story about the past. Well, if it's not a story about the past, why is a tree from that story accessible to you today, and you're eating from it today? It would seem that that would prove the story was indeed about something that happened in the past, if that tree is real. The story must have really happened. Not that you're eating from the right tree, because, again, to sum up, one, the tree of life has 12 fruit, and the tree you're eating from has only 10. Two, the tree you're eating from doesn't make you live any longer, like the tree of life is supposed to do. And three, the story says that the tree of life is blocked today anyhow. Now, it turns out that what that guy said is not even true. I don't know what rabbi told him that, and if that rabbi actually believes that or not, but either way, get a load of what the Gaon of Vilna says. Famous Kabbalist. I don't see how both descriptions can be true. The following passages are from The Secret Doctrine of the Gaon of Vilna, Volume 2, The Josephic Messiah, Leviathan, Metatron, and the Sacred Serpent. Listen, we'll get into that title later on in another video. Believe you me. Long story short, there's a freaking serpent in the tree, okay? Just want to let you know that little tidbit. Okay, let's read this. The rabbis have always taught that the tree of knowledge and the tree of life are one and the same. The tree of knowledge is only that part of the tree of life that is branching out into this lower and limiting dimension that then produces the phenomenon of multiplicity. It is the higher dimensional branching structure of the tree of dual knowing, versus the root structure of the tree of singular knowing. As we reach the edge of the branches in the lower dimensional tree, however, it does not actually end, but rather it curves back on itself, or, dependent upon the surface of the topological model we use, the end of linear days is simply inverting upon itself, and in so doing, transforming the entire spiritual as well as physical universe. The lower dimensional tree of knowledge now reveals itself to be the original hyperdimensional tree of life, whose roots are now in heaven, leading all the way back to the future, to the never-ending source of the light of the Ein Sof. The three C's of consciousness. The tree of knowledge, as well as the tree of life, is not an actual growth of vegetation. Such understanding is a primitive anthropomorphic projection. Rather, this tree is a field of higher dimensional dendrite-like midbrain structures of Adam HaRishon, who in turn is a microcosm and fractal of Adam Kadmon, the even higher dimensional soul of Adam HaRishon. Adam Kadmon is the original man, according to Judaism, the original combination of male and female in one human. That's what they think. The midbrain, with other middle brain structures, including the mysterious pineal body, pineal gland, third eye, is the dot, knowledge, the vortex of the cerebral spinal structure resting between the two hemispheres of the cerebrum and atop the spinal column.
There is a substance or liquid or a substance that comes from your medulla, which is basically completely looks like the Ark of the Covenant has angel's wings around it, the whole thing. So this substance comes from your medulla, makes the trip down your spine to your sacrum, which is
quick, get a dictionary.
Christ coming down into human form.
Yes.
And if you don't squander that essence, that sexual essence, it ascends again and goes back up to heaven, which is your thing.
So what does Jim Carrey believe here? He believes that something ascends his spinal column and enters his brain, and his brain, something in his brain actually is heaven. So he believes heaven is in his brain. And then take a look at this scripture. Jacob dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. Well, there you go. So the spinal column in this picture is the ladder. On top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the Lord stood above it. So in this theology, your own brain is the Lord. So you ascend the ladder up to your own brain, and then you realize that you are God.
I believe that the Godhead resides within oneself.
Now, Rabbi Schiff here on the right.
Some people need to start up here, some people need to start down here, and some people from the side. Like you said, 70 ways of doing it. In Jacob's ladder, only Hashem was on the top.
Well, I guess he has not come to the quote-unquote realization that he is God. By now, though, you might be tempted to think that maybe you are God. There seems to be some numerology that gives hints to that effect. After all, if Yahweh adds up to 26, and so does God, so does Adam, and Abraham, and ego, and brain, and logic, and focus, and think, well, you might just think that you're so clever as to have found the esoteric secret meaning of the scriptures, and that the surface meaning is just some kind of clever cover story. Not so fast. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, Thus saith the Lord God, Because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a god, I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas, yet thou art a man and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of God. Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee, I am God? But thou shalt be a man and no god, in the hand of him that slayeth thee. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? The Lashem clarifies this relationship. He writes, when God will purify the entire earth and extinguish evil and all of its manifestations in their entirety, then corporeality and physicality will be distilled, and all of it will be transformed into supernal luminosity. Then the entire tree of knowledge of good and evil will literally be transformed back into the tree of life. They say the tree of knowledge is the tree of life. Are you buying this?
This symbol, which we know in English as the tree of life, has been passed down through many generations.
Keep it secret, huh? Heck of a job, guys. Heck of a job.
Who was the person? Who was the person that decided that Kabbalah should be for the larger, the mass amounts of people? Who made that decision?
In Hebrew, Tree of Life translates to Etz Chaim, and in other traditions, it has been called Yggdrasil, the Eternal Banyan Tree, the Gea Karena World Tree, the Bodhi Tree, and was also known to a number of ancient traditions, such as those of the Egyptians, Sumerians, Assyrians, Christians, and even in ancient Chinese mythology, there is a concept of a world tree called the Tree of Life. The Tree of Life geometry that we are observing most commonly appears to derive from Jewish Kabbalah.
Then you've just tapped into the infinite source of everything and everyone.
The source is a living energy code, a system of eternal mathematical waveforms, pure frequencies.
Like a prisoner in a pitch black cell, we may never be able to see the walls of our prison. Why? Because they are vibrational walls, and I suggest that they are the speed of light.
It's a code of waves. This code is self-writing and self-optimizing. It doesn't need any external creator or anything to push it along.
Well, imagine you're designing a building, right? You consciously create each aspect. But sometimes it feels like it's almost creating itself, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Creation itself was just consciousness creating and inhabiting itself in that creation.
Yeah, like I'm discovering it.
Genuine inspiration, right? Mm-hmm. Now, in a dream, our mind continuously does this. We create and perceive our world simultaneously, and our mind does this so well that we don't even know what's happening. That allows us to get right in the middle of that process.
How?
By taking over the creating part. Now this is where I need you. You create the world of the dream.
How does something that as if happens in my thoughts influence reality so much? The entire universe, even if you talk to scientists, astronomers that are studying the universe, then they'll tell you that the entire universe is a thought.
Okay.
Right. You heard about this. Yes. Because this is how they feel it, that everything that we see, the galaxies, stars, it's all a thought. It's something that speaks, but about what? They can't say. They can't grasp it.
It's a self-fulfilling system internally programmed to maximize and optimize itself.
And it comes to us from the source, from the creator.
What this means is that the individual is eventually going to reunite with source, with the central light and sound of the creator. And when I say creator, I'm not talking about a being or a figure. I'm just talking about the source.
Okay, so who is this guy talking about the source? E.A. Coetting. Let me give you a little background on what this guy's about.
I'm now releasing this compendium of Lucifer, along with the video course Pathworking of Lucifer. And along with that, I'm going to be doing a ritual with Lucifer, a blood-packed synergy group ritual. Curtis Joseph and I are going to team up again to perform this ritual. Both of us are going to be acting as witnesses to the connection that you can make with Lucifer. We're going to be facilitating that connection, and we're going to give you full instructions on what you need to do on your end to fully embrace and merge with Lucifer.
Well, there you go. Dude is straight up making pacts with Lucifer, merging with Lucifer, being possessed by Lucifer. He's a self-proclaimed black magician. Now, let's take a look at what his theology is. What does he think the world is like, and what does he think the afterlife is like? And let's juxtapose this with what Kabbalist Jews also believe.
One door leads to the source.